At the end of June 1945, 2 weeks after I came back from concentration camp, I received a letter from my uncle in London asking me to describe what we went through during that period in the Second World War. I replied, "Dear uncle, if I write 1,000 pages, I can still not tell you everything that we went through." So I will try to guide you through the various events, hoping that will make it easier for you to understand what I went through. My name is Max Stern. I was born on the 2nd of March, 1921, into an observant middle-class family in Bratislava, then part of Czechoslovakia. I was the eldest of 7 children. My parents, together with my 2 youngest brothers, Jossi and Robi, were murdered in Auschwitz. Bratislava, known as Pressburg in German, was the capital of Slovakia. We lived in a 4-story gray stone apartment building with a central courtyard. With 7 children, there was not much room. The house we lived in was opposite the university, next to the bridge over the Danube River. There were 2 or 3 Jewish families in the building, including ourselves. In a city of 150,000 people, almost 10% was Jewish, but the culture of the city was very mixed. My siblings and I attended the Orthodox Jewish day school in Bratislava. The Jewish schools were concentrated in one area, whilst the Jewish shops and synagogues were dispersed throughout the city. Jews in Czechoslovakia lived as an integral part of the whole community. My father served in the First World War in the Red Cross unit of the Austro-Hungarian Army. And in Bratislava, it was not easy to support a family of 9 on a low income. In spite of our modest lifestyle, we had a happy home life with uncompromising respect to our parents and grandparents. After completing my primary education, my father sent me to study engineering in Vienna. That was in 1936. This peaceful and happy life came to an abrupt end when the Holocaust descended in Europe. On March the 12th, 1938, the Nazis invaded Austria. Everything changed quickly. They occupied Vienna on Friday night, and on my way to school on Saturday morning, yes, we had to attend school on Shabbat. I had a German friend who waited for me on Shabbat, and he carried my books to and from school. The Shabbat, after the Germans occupied Vienna, this friend of mine said to me, "For a dirty Jew, I don't carry any books." On my way to school, I saw Jews dragged into the streets and made wash the pavements with their toothbrushes. It is hard to understand how it could all happen so quickly. It seems that anti-Semitism started the day the Nazis marched in. The Austrians had lived in harmony with their Jewish neighbors for decades. Yet, they turned against them overnight. I could not continue my studies in Vienna, and had to return home to Bratislava. Because I attended German schools, the Slovak education authorities would not allow me to continue my studies in Bratislava. As one was registered in the census by the mother tongue, the Slovaks considered me German. It was just ironic that Jews who spoke German, including our family, were considered German nationals. In 1939, the Slovak fascist Hlinka movement declared an independent state of Slovakia and conspired with the Germans to eliminate the Jews. Locals went around in groups of four or five and beat up any Jew they saw walking in the streets. They did not invade businesses or homes at the time, but it was an open door policy. Whenever they could hit a Jew, they did so, and the police looked the other way. My father was soon unable to work due to the fact that his business contacts were all in occupied Sudetenland, and his source of income was lost. It became my responsibility to support the family with the proceeds of my stamp dealing. I sold stamps I had bought in Vienna whilst at school during the week, and Sundays sold them in Bratislava at the stamp booths. I regularly returned home Saturday night and then traveled back to Vienna on a local tram on Sunday night. I had no alternative but to start dealing in stamps as a form of income rather than a hobby. My family depended on me completely to be able to purchase the bare essentials required to maintain a household. Unfortunately, I was forced in this position and never had the opportunity to enjoy adolescence. I was just 17 years of age. Somehow, whether it was luck or providence, I made contacts and even formed friendships with people who were enthusiastic supporters of the Third Reich. In spite of all that was happening around us, I continued trading in stamps. Every Sunday morning and Tuesday night, there was a stamp booth or stamp collector's market. I went to places forbidden to Jews in the company of Nazis and the political police. There were many bizarre stories, but I was living a life full of danger for several years. I developed many contacts and luckily was able to use these to develop my stamp trading. I had connections with stamp dealers all over Europe. I made a reasonable living to support my family. People used to use stamps to send to neutral countries to convert into foreign currencies. Stamps are internationally neutral articles involving every currency deal imaginable. In contrast to my success in stamp dealing, my family was rapidly being torn apart. In the first week of May 1939, my two younger brothers, Kurt, 11, and Harry, 9, were fortunate enough to secure a place on the Kinder transport, which went to England. It was quite an emotional farewell. I still remember the day of their departure, lined up with other boys in front of a bus which took them across the border. On arrival, my brothers were placed into separate non-Jewish, with two separate non-Jewish families just outside London, where they spent the rest of the war. Our family managed in the early years to stay in contact with my brothers by sending messages through my German stand-in friend in Vaduz, Liechtenstein. As the anti-Semitic laws were put into action, one of many prohibitions were restricting Jews from trading. The way out of this was to find an Aryan person who would take over your business in name. I was lucky to be introduced to Maria Eigner, who took me into her book exchange shop where I could continue trading. Through her contacts, I was granted an exemption to wear the Yellow Star, which identified you as a Jew. This allowed me a bit more freedom of movement. I now lived under the name of Michael Stransky and later Michael Sadetsky. I managed to trade and live relatively unscathed between 1940 and 1942. Early in 1942, things changed dramatically. One day on my way home from work, I was picked up by the Gestapo for not wearing a Yellow Star. No questions asked, I was sent to a labor camp, Žilina, about 200 kilometers north of Bratislava. I treated it lightheartedly, as I had no idea how serious the situation has become. Slovak guards around the camp, we had enough food and even managed to wear civilian clothes. Towards the end of May, we were assembled outside the camp from where the prisoners were loaded into cattle carts and transported to Auschwitz. I was standing in the last row of the prisoners. As I was surrounded by high grass, I had the intuition to lie down in the grass and hoped I wouldn't be caught. I waited in the train until the train and the guards had left. Fortunately, they had no dogs on guard at the time. As the transport left, I simply stood up and returned into the camp unnoticed. After we had been in transit camp for several weeks, we were sent to the inner city to work in groups of 10 or 12 boys. One day, as we returned to the camp after work, I made my way to the back of the group. When nobody was watching, I left the group, mixed with the civilian population, until I found a train station back to Bratislava, avoiding ticket collectors as I had no money. Back in Bratislava, I obtained new papers and was able to continue trading in stamps. As time went by, there were more and more restrictions. My father and my uncle, together with many others, were prominent members of the underground resistance group. This was known as the Bratislava Group, which was under the leadership of Gizi Fleischmann and Rabbi Weissmandl, heroes of the Holocaust. My father was actively involved with the network, procuring diamonds, rare paintings, and Persian rugs. This was used to bribe officials. Eichmann's deputy in Bratislava was SS Hauptsturmführer Dieter von Wislizeni, who controlled deportation and was approachable and consistently accepted bribes in return for postponing deportation. Late in 1943, these activities of the underground group were discovered. All those who were involved were sent to a notorious prison, political prison, a prison in near our city. Fortunately, my father was released from the prison after a few weeks, and my father and my family were then exempt from deportation until 1944. As Hitler's final solution gained pace, we knew the time was not far off and we would all need to go into hiding. I had contacts through the underground and forged iron papers, at this time in the name of Milan Stransky, with the initials of MS from Extern. I also obtained forged Argentinian passports, which I never had the opportunity to use. In October 1944, late on Yom Kippur night, the Germans decided to make Bratislava Judenrein. All Jews were to be immediately deported, and all papers of exemption were declared invalid. I left home, and I never saw my parents again. I saw columns of people being led towards the railway station by SS guards with machine guns. I went to my previously arranged hiding place with only the clothes I was wearing. There were four of us. My school friend Fritz Bruck did not make it into the hiding place, which was in one of the large picture theaters in the city called the Redoute. Our hiding place was between the ceiling of the theater and the roof. Here we placed stretchers, prepared food. In hiding, it was very difficult for all of us. There was no privacy. All things you take for granted in everyday life become a problem. You can do with little food for a few days, but you cannot do without water, and there were no toilet facilities. The disposal of the human waste posed lots of problems. However, next room to our hiding place was a music school, teaching young boys the violin. The manager of the picture theater approached one of these boys and managed to get a violin case for us, and we wrapped the human waste in newspaper, which we put in the violin case, and one of us went downstairs with the students, disposed of the waste in a public toilet outside the theater. Sometimes during the theater shows, we had to hide in very small shafts through which we needed to wrangle like snakes. About 50 centimeters high, we nearly choked on the dust as we stayed there motionless and our stomachs for hours. A few weeks later, the Allies were heavily bombing Bratislava. There were almost daily raids. On December the 20th, 1944, during one of these raids, a 500-kilogram bomb crashed through the roof of the theater, but the bomb did not explode and left to hang between the beams in a small room next to our hiding next to our hiding place. The Germans ordered the theater to be evacuated. We had nowhere to go, but shifted to a room that our protectors, Mr. Drobny, locked from the outside. Those 3 days in a locked room without food, water, toilet facilities, coupled with the fear, were just terrible. Unfortunately, Mr. Drobny was picked up by the Gestapo, beaten and tortured until he disclosed our whereabouts. And then in the middle of the night, the Gestapo came but could not break the locked steel door. This gave us time to get to the shaft which led to the courtyard. We all escaped unharmed. It was winter, 2 days before Christmas. We were on the street without identity papers, in danger of being captured. One of my friends' family used to own a factory. We made our way towards this building to contact the caretaker, who agreed to hide us in a canal inside the factory. We made our way to the canal. It was very cold and wet. We tried to sleep, but the rats came and bit our fingernails. We just could not take it anymore and moved into a temporary hiding spot in his home. Unfortunately, we were found by the Gestapo early in the morning. A few days later, we were sent to Seret, a holding camp outside Bratislava. And from there, a 3-day journey in cattle wagons without food or water, our final destination, Sachsenhausen concentration camp. Sachsenhausen was the largest concentration camp on German soil and housed at one stage over 32,000 prisoners. In Sachsenhausen, we were shaved, given striped prison uniform and a number. As we went in the shower, we had to leave all our belongings, and after the shower, we left from another exit. I lost my name and identity as I became prisoner number 125,525. My days in Sachsenhausen were traumatic. The prisoners were dehumanized, and the animal instinct of survival took over. I had to adjust to living on 100 grams of bread and a bowl of so-called soup as a daily ration. Once we had been sent to our barracks, I asked an older prisoner how much longer we were here for and if there were any ways to escape from the camp. He looked at me and pointed to the thick gray smoke coming out of the chimneys from the crematorium. He replied, "This is the only way out of here." At this time, unknown to prisoners of Sachsenhausen, Auschwitz was already preparing for evacuation, and as part of a special commando group called the Sonderaufnahmekommando, who suffered torture and punishment by the SS guards. This group consisted of men aged between 20 and 30 and were housed in barracks in Lichtenrade, a camp 14 kilometers outside Sachsenhausen concentration camp. We slept in barracks, and as punishment, the guards would occasionally dismantle the windows in the middle of winter during the freezing cold nights. The icing conditions made it difficult to sleep. We had to assemble at 5:30 in the morning on the parade ground from where we were taken into the city of Berlin to clear debris from the streets and build anti-tank barricades. As the front moved closer, all we talked about was food, and whether we would survive or how we will die. I could talk endlessly about the conditions and suffering of what we endured during these final weeks of the war. The Russians were now advancing in the outskirts of Berlin. We had the feeling that the end of the war was near. But we did not know what our fate will be. On or about the 19th or 20th of April 1945, the order came to evacuate the camp of Lichtenrade, and we were forced to march 14 kilometers and join the other prisoners in Sachsenhausen. On the night of the 21st of April, the day after Hitler's birthday, all prisoners were assembled on the parade ground and to get ready for immediate evacuation. There were 30,000 or more prisoners who embarked on the death march. We received one spoon of flour in one hand and another spoon of cucumber salad as we walked out from the camp. Most of the prisoners were already starving and very weak. There was complete chaos, but still the Germans kept guard over prisoners, and anybody who was too weak simply stepped out and was shot in the head. Dead was no longer punishment. Death was a relief. At one point in the march, I became so weak that I decided I was going to give up. But my friend Oskar Schiller insisted that I continued on as the end of the war was near. The most traumatic event I ever witnessed on the march was when a prisoner stepped out of line, the guard shot off top of his head, and he just started to run with half his head shot off like a chicken without a head. It was an automatic reaction before he died. As we marched north towards Lübeck, more and more prisoners were dying or being shot. The war was already lost, but for us, it still went on. After 2 weeks on the death march, hunger gave way to weakness, and on the 6th of May, we rested in a forest and woke up in the morning to see machine guns surrounding us and no guards. They fled. We were free at last. I have often been asked my feelings on that day, and I always give the same answer: hunger. All other feelings have disappeared a long time ago. Since we left Sachsenhausen, we walked nearly 300 kilometers. We were liberated by the advancing Russian army and then sent to a Soviet army hospital, as we were weak, full of lice and paratyphoid. After 2 or 3 days, we left the hospital and were thinking of how, or talking of how we're going to get home. The Russians wanted to collect all the Eastern European prisoners to send them back on the transport. I said to my friend Oscar, I'm not going anymore on the transport. Somehow we got a cart and a horse, and we started our march back on foot to Berlin, where we found out there was a train operating in the morning going down to the Czechoslovakian border. And we caught one of these trains, arrived in Bratislava, and that was the homecoming. But the homecoming to whom? The homecoming to what? After a few days, I found my two sisters who returned from Auschwitz, and they confirmed my worst fears. My father, my mother, and two little brothers, Yossi, who would have been 11 years old, and Robbie, who would have been 7, as well as my grandmother, uncles, aunts, cousins, were gassed on the same day as they arrived in Auschwitz. The Holocaust must be placed as a plaque on the wall of human history, and its details must be known to all mankind. But for a Jew, the Holocaust is part and parcel of the personality of the nation, as important as is any other major event in Jewish history. All the paper and all the pens in the world could never fully tell the stories of the Holocaust. And now I would like to leave you with the following parting message. Whilst I want to forget, but I can't, you must remember and never forget. Without the past, there is no future. Thank you.